Welcome dear students to EPG Parshala. I am Dr. K.S. Nagaraja of Deccan College, Pune. We'll be teaching the course Historical Linguistics. In today's module, we will look at borrowing and its impact on the language. So far, in the earlier modules, we have looked at various types of changes which may affect the various aspects of the language, like sounds, words, form, grammar, sentence, etc. Here, the interest is that societies in the world on the whole do not live in isolation. After all, societies are the carriers of languages. Languages cannot live without societies. So that is the basic interest for linguists. When societies come in contact with each other, directly or indirectly, what happens to their languages is a question that is of great interest. In this module, we look at what happens to the languages when they come in contact with each other, at what level the impact could be. In fact, the simplest level is borrowing of lexical words. So in this module, we look at this aspect in some detail. So languages and dialects do not exist in a vacuum. Always there will be some contact with other language or dialect. The historical point of interest here is the contact of one group with the speech communities outside itself. The study of linguistic borrowing is inextricably bound up with the social and political history of a speech community. It is only the degree of that contact which may differ from language to language or dialect to dialect. Speaking generally, we can define borrowing as the process by which one language or dialect takes and incorporates some linguistic elements from another. Lexical borrowing is most common, and while sounds and grammatical structures are rarely borrowed. So we may start looking at the first one, the lexical borrowing. Lexical borrowing means borrowing of words or whole words. A very common result of linguistic contact is lexical borrowing. It is the most common type of interaction between languages. Words can be taken very freely from one language into another, with very little, if any, effect on the rest of the grammar or lexicon of the borrowing language as such. To take the most simple and obvious case, suppose a speech community borrows some foreign cultural item. At the same time, it might well take into its language the name of that item from the language of the culture supplying it. Some clear examples are the names of foods: pizza, soup, sausage, curry, omelette, pav, ananas, anar, ketchup, etc. Similarly, we can think of pepper, rice. All have entered various languages. For instance, pepper, ultimately of ancient oriental origin. In Sanskrit, we have pipali, long pepper. It came early to Germanic peoples via Latin piper. Rice, probably ultimately from Dravidian source, Dravidian ari or ariki means rice, paddy. Compare Tamil, ari, arichi, via Latin ariza and Greek Aruza. Similarly, sugar, ultimately from Arabic sucre, through Old French Shukra. In, however, there is a feeling that the word entered from India to Arab. So the original point would be probably India. Coffee from Arabic, kahwa, infusion, beverage, originally said to have meant some kind of wine, borrowed through the Turkish pronunciation kahve, from which European languages get their items. It is not, of course, necessary to absorb an item culturally before borrowing its name linguistically. For a word to travel from a lending to a borrowed language, all that is necessary is that the concept be within the borrowing speech community, or at least within a subgroup that desires to speak about something foreign. Thus, while neither a lama, Tibetan monk, nor a llama, Peruvian beast of burden, has become a part of the culture of any English-speaking group, both are acceptable English words, known to even moderately educated speakers. Borrowing from one specialized subgroup by a similar one in a different speech community is something that takes place all the time. Such borrowed words may not make their way out of specific areas of specialized groups for a long time, if ever. Thus, English-speaking linguists are familiar with the German words ablaut, umlaut, though these words may not be known to the general public. The natural question arises is why borrowing takes place. Or in other words, what is the motivation for borrowing? The borrowing takes place when, normally speaking, when there is a need felt in the society or the community about lack of something or some word for that matter. That means, in other words, when a particular community accepts the culture of the other community, along with the culture, they accept various terminologies available connected with them. So, first and foremost, the need, why a particular word is needed in the language. Probably in this language, it is not originally available, so a borrowed word is taken. Or it is also the second is the prestige motive. Using the word of the other language is more prestigious than the one available in the native language or the source language. In fact, in our Indian context, we see this to a great extent. Virtually every language has borrowed from the other language. In fact, Indian languages in the earlier times, for that matter, borrowed extensively from Sanskrit, particularly in the area of worshipping or religion. We see lots of words. In the present day, later on, during the Mughal period, lots of words from the Perso-Arabic sources entered the Indian languages, particularly due to need or due to force, for that matter, when Perso-Arabic was accepted, Persian language was accepted as the medium of court, education, etc. Automatically, lots of words entered the Indian languages. And in the present situation, almost all languages are borrowing or have borrowed extensively from English. In between, of course, we know that many Portuguese words, French words have entered some of the Indian languages. Pau, Anar, etc. have entered Indo-Aryan languages like Konkani, Marathi. So they are from Portuguese source. Lots of words from English like police, wristwatch, plenty of them in education, in medicine, in any name, any area one may name, we find vocabulary from English language. In fact, the unfortunate situation is that the situation has come to such a state that even though local vocabulary is available, local words are available for those concepts, still people prefer to use the borrowed ones here. In a way, it is a prestigious motive associated with the borrowed words that is happening. So for borrowing, either need filling reason motive or prestige motive are the two major reasons can be identified. Naturally, how words are borrowed? How words are borrowed? Usually we take the words, in fact, if they are day-to-day words like bus, radio, or a train, aeroplane, we simply borrow them. But then when we borrow, it's possible that the formal part, that is the form, the sounds, may get remodeled to fit the phonological and morphological structure of the borrowing language, at least in the early stages of language contact. For instance, a word like coffee borrowed into, for instance, a language like Kannada, where fricative sounds, fricative fa is not found, it undergone the change to a plosive one because plosive pa is there, so it becomes kapi. But then it is not pronounced kapi by the educated class, who consider it is prestigious to pronounce the fricative. They insist pronouncing it as coffee, whereas the other people, that is those who do not know English, the native people tend to pronounce it as copy. This is just one instance. There are lots of instances where the words undergo changes. In fact, we may mention many of the words from English which have entered Indian languages. Though they had fricative sounds, because English is rich in fricatives, they get modified to become stops in Indian languages. In fact, a scholar, Henry Hawk, has made a detailed study of the type of borrowing into Indian languages. Two conditions for borrowing. The speaker of A must understand or thinks he understands the particular utterances in dialect B which contains the model. The speaker A must have some motive, overt or covert, for the borrowing, as I said earlier, need filling and or prestige. Need filling: when speakers of a language acquire some new item or concept from outside, they need a new term to go along with a new acquisition. Often a foreign name is borrowed along with the new concept. That is why many languages have similar words for coffee, paper, kagaz, and so many items, tobacco, and such. The other main reason why words are taken over from another language is for prestige, because the foreign term for some reason is highly esteemed. Borrowings for prestige are sometimes called luxury loans. We can think of some examples here. English case, meat. Earlier it was for, it could be of any animal, pig, cow, bull, ox. But in French, pork had a separate term specifically meant for pig, beef specifically meant for cattle. Also, the word cuisine, which meant kitchen from French, prestige, during the period of Norman French dominance in England. Besides need filling and prestige, there could be a third cause or third motive for borrowing. Opposite of prestige is due to negative evaluation, called derogatory reason. Adoption of the foreign word to be derogatory. French borrowed words like habler, to brag, to boast, from Spanish habler, to speak. Finnish kani, nag, or the old horse, from Russian koin, for this very purpose. How do words get borrowed? When words are borrowed, they usually get remodeled to fit into the phonological and morphological structure of the borrowing language, at least in the early stages of language contact. When the words are accepted with some minor modifications, phonological modification, it is known as adaptation. And in this, a foreign sound in a word, in a foreign word, which does not exist in the receiving language, will be replaced by the nearest phonetic equivalent to it in the borrowing language. For instance, the word coffee, which is taken into Indian context, often because the lack of the fricative f, it will be replaced by p and would get copy. This would be a case of adaptation. Similarly, in Hindi, when English words with initial consonant clusters are borrowed, they had to undergo a declusterization, either in two ways, station becoming cetacean or station, school becoming sakool or school. So that's how the adaptations take place. And this is one of the most common forms of accepting the words from one language into another. However, there are many different kinds of language contact situation, and the outcome of borrowing can vary according to the length and intensity of the contact, the kind of interaction, and the degree of bilingualism in the populations. In situations of more extensive, long-term, or intimate contact, new phonemes can be introduced into the borrowing language together with borrowed words which contain these new sounds, resulting in changes in the phonemic inventory. One very significant fact about borrowing is that the borrowed words are assimilated into the phonemic system of the borrowed language. That means, after a word has been fully absorbed into a new language, it sounds like an ordinary word of that language and is subject to all its rules. Sounds which do not occur in the borrowing language are either dropped or replaced by familiar native ones. An example of the complete loss of phonemes is the borrowing from tonal languages into non-tonal languages. We completely ignore the tones of Chinese words in words like chomen or no tao, though in Chinese they must be pronounced with specific pitch contours or registers in order to convey the proper meaning. Loan words are not only remodeled to accommodate aspects of the phonology of the borrowing language, they are also usually adapted to fit the morphological patterns of the borrowing language. Once a word is borrowed and it becomes nativized, it becomes one of the regular words, and it is capable of taking the number markings, case markings, etc., as if it's one of the native words of the language. How do we identify loan words and determine the direction of borrowing? In dealing with borrowings, we want to ascertain which language is the source, the donor, and which the recipient. The borrowing criteria, perhaps better called rough rules of thumb, address these questions. Phonological clues. The strongest evidence for loan word identification and the direction of borrowing comes from phonological criteria. Phonological patterns of the language of the words containing sounds which are not normally expected in native words or candidates for loans. Like case of a tribal language called Korku, belonging to Munda group, where it has obtained length contrast and aspirate stops, all because of the influence of Indo-Aryan languages. And similarly, of course, we may mention the case of Kannada, a Dravidian language, which has obtained aspirated stops, though originally it did not have aspirated stops, all because of the close contact of Sanskrit for many centuries. So phonological history, in some cases where the phonological history of the languages of a family is known, information concerning the sound changes that they have undergone can be helpful for determining loans and the direction of borrowing and what the donor language was. So as I mentioned earlier, Sanskrit to Dravidian languages is one aspect versus Dravidian to Sanskrit. It's interesting to note that in the both the groups, from Sanskrit to Dravidian, lots of words have entered, whereas Sanskrit has obtained the rotaphonic series from Dravidian, particularly in the Vedic Sanskrit, which is a well accepted feature. Now here, what scholars have observed is that it is not that Sanskrit has directly borrowed the sounds, the rotaphonic sounds, but it has taken the words with the rotaphonic sounds, and also in due course of time, even the native words, some of them have changed to rotaphonic. So that way, we observe not only the borrowed words having the rotaphonic series, but also some of the native words do have that one. So there is a contrast between the rotaphonic series and the non-rotaphonic series. Then the morphological complexity, the morphological makeup of words can help determine the direction of borrowing. For example, English alligator borrowed from Spanish el lagarto, the alligator, since it is monomorphemic in English, but based on two morphemes in Spanish, el, the, logarto, alligator. So the direction of borrowing must be from Spanish to English. That means Spanish, it was a compound one made of two morphemes, whereas when it is taken as one in English, the chances are that the direction of borrowing is from Spanish to English, not the reverse. English vinegar, a monomorphemic form, is borrowed from French, because in French it is bimorphemic. Vinegar, which is from vin, or means wine, and cigre is sour. So from that we get vinegar. The same principle works here, a bimorphemic becoming monomorphemic. The direction should be from the bimorphemic to the mono, that is the English. The Sanskrit word kana, one-eyed, appears to be borrowed from Proto-Dravidian kan. Kan means I plus a negative suffix, according to a scholar Zwelabel. And it is the morphological complexity of the Dravidian form which shows the direction of borrowing. Of course, though it is a very strong criterion, it may be tampered by folk etymology, as it has happened in English. French monomorphemic word crevice, which meant crayfish, was borrowed into English, and then later this was replaced by folk etymology with crayfish on the analogy of with fish. Clues from cognates: when a word in two or more languages is suspected of being borrowed, if it has legitimate cognates across sister languages of one family but is found in only one language or a few languages of another family, then the donor language is usually one of the languages for which the form in question has cognates in the related languages. Again, here the illustration is from Spanish. Gonzo means goose, borrowed from Germanic guns, Here this Germanic has cognates from German guns, English goose, etc. But Spanish word has no true cognate in other Romance languages. Therefore, this is a borrowing from Germanic into Spanish. Similar cases can be seen. The geographical and ecological association of words suspected of being loans can often provide clues helpful to determine whether they are borrowed and what the identity of the donor language. For example, words like zebra, gnu, impala, etc., the animals originally found only in Africa, make these words likely candidates for borrowings into English. Loans as clues to linguistic changes in the past, evidence preserved in loan words, as already mentioned in case of Vedic, Sanskrit and Dravidian, may help to document older stages of a language before later changes took place. A comparison of Finnish word like rangas and kuningas, which mean king, also borrowed from Germanic, Proto-Germanic kuningos, shows that Germanic originally contrasted, for example, A in the position before N, which is not seen in Germanic after the two sounds merge before N. Second, both these loans document the Proto-Germanic ending as through comparisons from other branches of Indo-European. Like this, there are the loanwords do undergo modifications. They indicate what could be the possible source of them if we study them carefully. Normally, loanwords are considered to be of four types. Loanword means a word which is borrowed from one language into another directly without any change, though with phonetic modifications. An instance would be loanwords from Dravidian found in Vedic language, Vedic literature would be of this type. Some such words have been listed above. A few more are listed here. Dravidian to Sanskrit, Mayura, this is from Tamil, Mayil means peacock, has entered Sanskrit. Budbuda, this is from Telugu, Buddha Buddha, bubble, bubbling noise. Again, Pala, from Tamil, Payam, fruit, etc. Show that many words have entered from Dravidian into Sanskrit. Then the question comes, what all can be borrowed at the lexical time? Because we know that a language will have various types of words like nouns, verbs, adjectives, adverbs, prepositions or postpositions, etc. Whether all the types of words are borrowed equally easily or some forms, some type of words are borrowed. The study has been made taking various languages into account, and it shows that the majority of the words are nouns which are borrowed. Next comes the verbs. Of course, the difference between the nouns and the verbs is too great, whereas nouns are borrowed almost 70-75%. Verbs come poor second with some 15-16%. The other categories like adjectives, adverbs fall much far low. So it is well known that nouns are borrowed in the first instance. When the contact becomes too strong, the impact of borrowing becomes much more stronger, and it is likely that the borrowing will not get restricted to nouns only. Other form classes could be borrowed. Though we said the lexical borrowing is most common, and we have observed among the lexical borrowing, nouns are the ones which are very likely to be borrowed. Syntactic borrowing is also possible, but it is definitely not very common. This is more unusual than phonological borrowing. This is a case of borrowing whole constructions. For instance, in English, we see presence of Attorney General, Postmaster General, Court Martial. Here, adjective follows the noun as it does in the source language, that is French. These are borrowed from French. This type of formation has remained more or less peripheral to English language. Similarly, original Turkish structure, adjective plus noun, akil plus adam, that is smart man, but donanma e humayun, the imperial fleet, that is fleet plus imperial, is the there is the native Turkish word donanma, so should not be used in this construction, but it has been used. Persian, noun plus a plus adjective, katab ye bozog, big book, mardan ye khub, good man. This is the regular pattern, whereas the earlier one is not the regular one. When we discuss borrowed words, a word is normally known as a loan word. Already in the beginning itself, I mentioned about the concept of loan. In any case, when the words are borrowed, four types of loans are identified. That means when a word is borrowed, whether the word is borrowed as a whole or with some modifications, etc. So on that basis, we make a distinction between loan word, loan shift, loan blend, and loan translation. So when a word is borrowed, normally we call it as a loan word. The very word loan is not very appropriate, but that has become the accepted word. Loan words are not only remodeled to accommodate aspects of the phonology of the borrowing language, they are also usually adapted to fit the morphological patterns of the borrowing language. For instance, when a word like pen is borrowed into Indian language, pen or book, the plurals are not pens, books. In the, suppose it is Kannada, then it becomes pennugalu, book or books, bookugalu, table galu, from table. So it's possible, it's very likely that once a noun is borrowed into the target language, then it becomes a normal word in that language and it undergoes same morphological processes as other native words of the language. At first, each of these whole words must have functioned in English as a single morpheme, but English had also borrowed some of the verbs which in French underlay the adjectives, and in due time there came to be a sufficiently large number of pairs of borrowed words for the recurrent termination to take on the function of the derivational affix in English. So we have bearable, eatable, drinkable. So a whole word has been segmented into the root plus the suffix on the analogy of the native structure. The following are a few of borrowings, borrowed directly: calico, banyan, pyjama, bandicoot, mongoose, mango, bakshis, right, bazaar, coolie, khaki, hartal, khadar, etc. These are the Indian words borrowed into English because of the long contact the Britishers had with India. Another interesting case can be reported here. Kannada borrowed lots of Sanskrit words, and it borrowed words which had suffixes also. So it one of the suffixes is kara, maker, a derivative suffix kara from Sanskrit, in such loans as kumbha kara, pot maker, kumbha pot maker, and then extended its use to native words like kolukara, Volekara. Kolukara is a messenger or a stick maker or who carries the stick. Then by the change of medial ka to ga, it became gara and is used in words like mosagara, that is a cheater, player atagara, etc. So it has been accepted as a regular derivative suffix of the language. Similarly, the suffix ika found in dharmika, laukika, when borrowed, Kannada extended this suffix to words like kobbiga, kannada, kannadiga. Similarly, the suffix maya introduced into Kannada through words containing mrinmaya, jyotirmaya, again from Sanskrit, was later extended to kallumaya, kesarumaya, kolakumaya. Kallumaya is full of stones, full of dirt, full of waste, etc. The second type is loan shift. When confronted with a new object or practice for which words are needed, the borrower may not accept the donor's words along with the new cultural item or concept. Instead, he may somehow adopt material already available in his own language. This is where the meaning is borrowed and the form is generated with native material. That's why it's called loan shift. The precise adaptation, however, may be in one way or another patterned on the donor's verbal behavior. Portuguese grosseria meant a rude remark. Portuguese immigrants in USA use it in the sense of grocery due to the influence of English. The history of the word library in America is also same. The borrowing of a word or phrase from another language with a simultaneous modification of its phonological shape so that it takes for a native one, as can be seen in Hindi, bungalow. The second type is loan blend. Loan blend means that when something is borrowed, the part of it is maintained, but also a part is taken from the native language and a blend is obtained, so we get loan blends. For instance, we may look at the loan words with some examples. The borrower may adopt the donor's word along with the object or practice. The new form in the borrower's speech is then a loan word. In other words, a linguistic unit, usually a lexical item, which has come to be used in a language or dialect other than the one where it originates. So, for example, Middle English originated, acquired a large number of Norman French adjectives containing the derivational suffix able or evil, like agreeable, excusable, variable, etc. Similar constructions can be found in most of the languages. The fourth type is loan translation, where the word is not borrowed, but the concept is taken and the concept is replaced by the native vocabulary and we get a new word. So it's a very interesting case here. In English, for instance, we have two words, handbook and manual. Handbook is a native word, whereas manual is borrowed from French. There may be an official government policy or an unofficial feeling that the purity of the language must be preserved from the incursions of foreign words. As a result of this attitude, when the need arises to borrow a word, these languages tend to use a process known as loan translation, which is also called calking, as I already mentioned. What basically involved here is that translating the component parts of the foreign word into roots native to the borrowing language. For example, English lightning war, alone translating the German word blitzkrieg, which is itself a product of compounding blitz, lightning and krieg war. Black market, a loan translation of German, Schwarzmarkt, composed of Schwarz, black and marked market. Similarly, in Hindi, Gaganasakhi is of this type. Gaganasakhi is from air hostess, or Doordarshan, television, Doorvani, telephone, or another interesting case in Sanskrit, Dvija, from in English it becomes twice born, or some interesting cases of this type. In certain languages like French and German, there has been a decided tendency to prefer loan translation to simple borrowing, whereas a similar tendency can be found in Chinese. However, Japanese, for instance, prefers loans rather than loan translation. For instance, Chinese, a word like boyfriend is interpreted in Chinese as non pengyu by loan cocking, male friend it means. In Japanese, boy furendo. Similarly, girlfriend becomes new pengyu, whereas in Japanese becomes garu furendo. Like this, it is the nature of the languages which prefers either a direct borrowing or loan translation. In case of Hindi, we have a very interesting situation. Once it has become the official language, depending upon the domain of the use, the native word and the borrowed word have been accepted. For instance, Doorbhash, which means for speech or telephone, whereas phone or telephone is the adoption, is also used. Karyalay is adaptation, work, it means work abroad, whereas office is direct borrowing. Similarly, Sammelan is gathering, whereas meeting is the loan. Samskaran is loan translation, whereas edition is loan word. Like this, we have a very interesting situation, mainly because Sanskrit, English now is the official language. In order to fulfill the needs of the official language, some sort of technical terms are required. When such words are required, they naturally go back to Sanskrit and take from the genius of Sanskrit into the language. So loan words involve morphemic importation with or without sound substitution. Loan shifts or loan translations involve morphemic substitution without morphemic importation or sound substitution. Loan blends involve both morphemic importation and morphemic substitution with or without sound substitution. So we may look at the cultural inferences of borrowing, because as I mentioned earlier, extensive borrowing will have impact on the not only on the language but also on the culture of those who speak that language. It is not difficult to see how loan words can have an important historical impact on any culture. Consider what the newspapers in your language will have. Rice, which is ultimately from Dravidian Ari or Ariki, which means rice and paddy, both in Tamil. But via Latin, Orissa, and Greek, Orissa. That means that in those days, in the earlier days, there was a seafaring and connection between the Greece and South India. And it likely that the Greeks took rice with them, and along with the material, they took the word also. That's how rice has entered there, which is Arichi in Tamil. So either due to trade practices, the words are taken from one language to another. There, it will not affect the other forums, only they remain only at the word level, maybe a few lexical items. being affected. However, intense cultural contact will have much greater say much more drastic in the impact. In fact, we will be looking at some of these things in other modules in the days to come. So, to summarize, borrowing is a very important phenomenon in language. Interestingly, the word borrow is not the suitable one. Unlike in the financial transactions, when somebody gives some money to another person, he will be less of that much money. But in case of language, the basket is always full, however much one gives from that one. So that is a parody. The word borrowing still is used because it has been accepted as a technical term in this context. So though it is not that appropriate, it is used still. And in fact, the students are advised to study their own languages or the languages surrounding them and see what words are there, which are borrowed, and is there any trend in borrowing or direction in borrowing. That would be a very good way of understanding the concept of borrowing. Of course, the related concepts are the bilingualism and multilingualism. Some of these will be seen later. And one may refer to lots of books which deal with this, and e-journals are available where there also one can get information about borrowing. Thank you.